बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम। अस्सलाम वालेकुम क्लास। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू टेक आवर फर्स्ट ऑनलाइन लेक्चर विच आई विल अपलोड ऑन माय एजुकेशनल चैनल एंड यू विल सी एंड वॉच एंड लिसन फ्रॉम देयर आफ्टर सब्सक्राइबिंग माय चैनल बाय क्लिकिंग द बेल बटन एंड आफ्टर दैट इन द होल पीरियड ऑफ कोरोना एज लॉन्ग एज द University do not resume the classes. You can get all the presentation, all the helping material, and the lectures from my channel. And if one time you will subscribe it, it will automatically intimate you whenever I will put the new lecture in the new class on my channel. So today's lecture topic is method to study the macromolecules. This is a general topic in which number of techniques are involved which are used to study the macromolecules, and the macromolecules to which we are concerned are mainly the protein, RNA, DNA, carbohydrates, lipids, cholesterol, etc. These macromolecules, as we know, are the bulky molecules and have the high molecular weight and have the high number of atoms and electrons and bond present in them. So to study their pure biochemical nature, we have to see their structure and their structure conformation as well. To study these macromolecules, there are number of techniques in which spectroscopy, mass spectroscopy, Mollendorf, X-ray crystallography, NMR, and like these type of other techniques are used which help us to study the macromolecules. Today the subtopic of our lecture is the X-ray crystallography. To study the macromolecule, first we have to get their image, and from their image we can make their three-dimensional structure. And to getting the three-dimensional structure of any macromolecule, X-ray crystallography is a powerful tool and a technique with which we can get the each and every fine details of the atoms and their bond present in any macromolecules. So if we want to get the three-dimensional structure of any macromolecule, we have to get an image of that molecule. Are the macromolecules, but they are not so big that we can see them by our naked eyes. They are still very small. Why they are called the macromolecules? Because they are the very big compared to the normal molecules. And if we see the fine bonded arrangement of the atom in a macromolecules, we have to use a wavelength which have a very short range of its wavelength, and it have the high frequency, because the maximum in the smallest bond which is formed between the hydrogen to hydrogen atom is not more than 1.5 angstrom. So if we want to see that interaction and that bond, we have to use a wavelength, a radiation which have a shorter wavelength than this bond length. And there are the number of radiations, and X-ray is one of electromagnetic radiation which have high frequency, high energy and low wavelength. And we know that if the radiation have the high energy and high frequency, they will have the low wavelength, they will have the ability to see the more details in the macromolecules. So the X-rays are used with whose wavelength is almost equal to 1 angstrom for getting the image of the macromolecule, and that image is used to get the true picture or the three-dimensional structure of that macromolecule. X-ray crystallography is a method of for studying the three-dimensional atomic structure of the molecule. But now in this lecture we will concentrate on the application of the biological macromolecule to which we are concerned. So first of all, if we have to get the image from the X-rays crystallography, then we should know how the X-rays be produced. The X-rays can be produced by the bombardment of the accelerated electrons from any source to the metal atoms, which are commonly copper and the molybdenum. In this way, this when high electron collides with and displaces an electron from a low lying orbital in a target metal atom, then an electron from the higher orbital will move from the high orbital from the high energy state to the low energy state, emitting its excess energy as an X-rays photon. These X-rays can be bombarded on a macromolecule, but a single macromolecule is a weak scatterer of X-rays. When we will bombard these X-rays on a single molecule, the X-rays will pass through the molecule without being diffracting. The diffracted rays are too weak to be detected, so we cannot bombard these X-rays on a single molecule. And we also know that we cannot visualize a single molecule directly. The solution of this problem is that we can make a crystal of that macromolecule. A crystal is a repeating unit of the molecules in a regular array, in an ordered arrangement, in which at least 10^14 number of molecules are present in a crystal and of a macromolecule. And if we will diffract that crystal, we can get a diffraction pattern. Unlike the visible light, UV and visible light, X-rays cannot be focused by lens. The refractive index of the X-rays in all the material is very close to 1.0. So we have to use the computer simulation to construct the image, as in other cases we use the lenses. In short, the computer plays the part of the objective lens, computing the image of the object, then displaying it on a screen. But before we compute the image, we should have the clear idea about the diffraction. Diffraction is a characteristic wave phenomena where whenever a wave front encounter an obstruction, in our case it's a macromolecule bonds or electron density that alter the amplitude or phase of a part of wave front, and this phenomena is called diffraction. The component of the wave front, both the unaffected and the altered, will interfere with one another, causing an observable energy density distribution referred to as the diffraction pattern. This diffraction pattern can be destructive interference and be the constructive interference. A crystal is composed of many repeating unit cell in the three dimensional and therefore act like a three dimensional diffraction grating. The constructive interference from a diffracting crystal is observed as a pattern of points on the detector. The relative position of these points are related mathematically to the crystal unit cell's dimension. The diffracting the diffraction grating image can be obtained, and their diagrams are given in the video. As we have to diffract the crystal, not the single molecule, so we should know and we have to know the nature of the crystal and how we make the crystals of any macromolecule. Actually, we know that under the certain circumstances, the molecule, that the protein, DNA and the RNA can form the crystals. And now there are many composition with the screening with the name of screens for making the crystals are available in the market, and if we use them properly, we can get the crystals of our macromolecule. To get the crystals of the macromolecule is a long and tedious job, but we have to cope with them. The resulting crystal actually is a three-dimensional array of ordered molecules that are held together by the non-covalent interaction of any macromolecule. And if we want to get an image for the X-ray crystallography to determine the three-dimensional structure, we must have the crystals of that macromolecule under study. But at the same time, the question is that, are the crystal have the same structure of that macromolecule which is present in the solution form? For that, there are number of evidence that NMR, which is the structure determination tool for the macromolecule in the solution form, and the X-ray crystallography, which the structure determination which from the crystal, have been used to determine the structure of the same molecule. The two methods produce the similar models. Many macromolecules are still functional in the crystalline form, and in the macromolecule which are concerned are the biomolecules, which are the DNA, RNA and the protein that contain 60-70% solvent. So the crystal image is a completely viable image to determine the three-dimensional structure for any micromolecule. and you can see the structure diagram of a crystal in which the object formed by stacking a basic unit in all the three dimension is called the unit cell, and that unit cell, if arrange themselves in the three dimensional, they become a crystal. Then there are the types of the crystal. The real crystal is one with less than perfect periodicity. Imperfections are often caused by the impurities, and that effects of non-zero temperature. The ideal crystal is that in which the ordered disposition of molecules, such as three, that there exists a regular pattern of 3D space where the repetition extend over a distance equal to or greater than thousands of the molecular dimensions. The protein crystal contain 70% of liquid, creating the disorder, and it shows that the number of the molecules in the crystal are not in the crystalline state. We have to bombard the crystal, not the macromolecule in the solution, by the X-rays. So we should know how to get the crystal of a macromolecule. To get the crystal of the macromolecule, we make the macromolecule solution super saturated. And we know what is the saturation and what is the super saturation from our previous classes. Super saturation is thermodynamically an unstable state that can be achieved most often in the protein crystallography by the vapor diffusion or by the slow vaporization. In the supersaturation solution, there are the three zones. First zone is called metastable zones. The solution may not nucleate for a long time in this zone, but will sustain the growth. It is frequently necessary to add a seed crystal for the metastable zone. The nucleation zone, in the nucleation zone, protein crystal nucleate and grow. And in the precipitation zone, protein do not nucleate but precipitate out of the solution. The nucleation is a phenomena in which a dust particle, a tiny seed crystal, or a small protein aggregate start the crystallization process, and from that nucleation the other molecules stacking on that nucleus, and a crystal is made of that macromolecule. Sometime the succession of growth take place caused by the development of the growth factor or the approach of the solution to the equilibrium, approaches of the solution to the equilibrium. The solution in which the crystal exists, this is often not the same as the original solution in which we put our macromolecule and try to get the crystal, but is instead the solution that exists after the some degree of vapor diffusion, equilibration and the evaporation. And this solution is called the mother liquor. There are number of the factors that can affect your crystallization process, in which the purity of your macromolecule, the purity and the concentration of your macromolecule, starting condition, and the solution you made, the purity of that solution in which you put your macromolecule, the precipitating agent, temperature, pH, additive detergents, reducing agents, and substrates and the cofactor. All of these have to keep in mind the pure and the optimal for the crystallization to occur. After getting the crystal can be mounted on a machine and X-rays bombardment of beam bombardment plays on that one, and these X-rays will be diffracted by the electron cloud around the atoms in the crystal, and that atomic structure can be deduced from that data. To get the crystal, there are some methods, and vapor diffusion and the hanging drop method and the sitting drop methods. In the hanging and sitting drop methods are given in the slides in the video. The hanging drop methods, the drop of the crystal screens are the solution in which you are going to make the crystal, and the macromolecule is hanging on the cover slip of the beaker, and in the sitting drop vapor method, the drop vapor diffusion, the drop is sitting on a mounted slide in the jar, and in this method, with the help of the vapor diffusion, the supersaturation, the nucleation zone can be created and the crystal can be obtained. After getting the crystal have to be examined, that these are the protein crystal or the crystal from the solution, inorganic solution, salt solution, and these salt solution crystal and the protein crystal are the crystal of your macromolecules can be determined by small techniques, that is it the crystal from the protein or from the screening solution. The protein solution, for example, can be checked by the SDS page, and you can know that it is a real protein of your macromolecule of exact molecular size. After getting the crystal, you have an experimental setup to mount your crystal on that that machine and bombard the X-ray beam on that crystal to get the X-ray diffraction pattern, and from the diffraction pattern you can get the structure of your macromolecule. That structure can be determined, and that also have the number of the faces. First, the diffraction pattern will be achieved, and that diffraction on that diffraction pattern will be converted with the help of the number of the software. For example, the phasor and molecular replacement method are used to get the electron density map of that macromolecule, and then by using the fitting software, for example COOT and some other software, you can get the atomic model of that macromolecule. From that atomic model you can construct the three-dimensional structure, and this will be the exact three-dimensional structure of that macromolecule under study, and it will have each and every fine details of the of the structure, with the bond angles, bond length, number of atoms, number of bonds, energy distribution around the electron density, and this atomic model is used in everywhere to study and to tell the other biological properties of that macromolecule. Thank you. I hope this is a long lecture, and it is a very informative. It will be a learning for you if you will go in detail and take every step, give every step at least 1 hour. Every part, for example, what is the diffraction, what is the X-ray, and what is how to get the crystal, and how to get the structure. The every part needs the many times study, and study from the other sources if you have, and then you can get a clear picture of X-rays crystallography. for the macromolecule, and it is one of the best method to get a three-dimensional crystal structure of the macromolecule.